Experiment 29 deals with amino acids and proteins. Let's have a look at the pre-lab review page. Question number one deals with specific safety alerts, so look for the triangle icons in your reading. That'll help you. Number two deals with specific disposal directions. Look for the garbage can icons. And none of these questions are too hard. You'll find the answers as you read the introduction to each of the experiments. And I'll give you a clue for number nine, though, as a reward for listening to this video. The Bayouret test, positive Bayouret test, is when the solution becomes pink-purple in color. And a Millen test forms a dark red solution, or red to a dark red precipitate. Here are the data and report pages now. And in this experiment 29, students separate amino acids using chromatography, paper chromatography. And that involves putting a piece of paper into a solution. The solution climbs the piece of paper, and as it does so, it separates the amino acids that have been spotted on the paper. The very first thing that's asked for here is the unknown ID number. Remember that you'll get that when you enter ChemWeb. It's a unique four-digit number that only you have. You're welcome to work with other students on the experiments, but when it comes to reporting the data, remember to use your own data because it might be unique to that unknown number. The mobile phase, another word for mobile is solvent. As the solvent climbs the paper, you'll record the distance that it has moved, and the tenth is your clue that you should record to the tenth. Might be 5.3 or 6.2 or whatever, but record that distance to the tenth. And you'll also do that with these amino acids, recording them, recording the distance they've migrated to the tenth. And at the bottom of this table is where you'll record the distance that your unknown has migrated on the piece of paper. There are three blanks. You may not use all of those blanks. If your unknown has three components, then you'll have three spots and three different distances to record. But maybe your unknown only has one N or two amino acids, so you may not use all of those blanks. Over here on the right-hand side is where you use this data in reporting, and you'll calculate the RF value, the distance that the spot has migrated over the distance that the solvent migrates. And these values now can be recorded to the hundredth. So the grader will look for that. So be sure and record to the hundredth. Down here at the bottom of that table, up above, you've listed the RF values. Down here, you'll identify the amino acids that are actually in your unknown. Maybe one, two, or three, but use their names right there in that part. Part B deals with the isolation of casein. Casein is a protein that's present in milk. It's separated from milk and goes through a various workup. Where you isolate the casein. And when you record weights, remember that you can record to three decimal places. Over here on this side, when you actually calculate the percent of casein, the grader will look for three significant figures. So a little tip on that. Part C deals with amino acid structure and pH. And the pH of various amino acid solutions are compared to the pH of water. Even pure distilled water rarely has a pH of 7. It's because of the carbon dioxide that's in the air. It dissolves in the water, and as it does so, it forms carbonic acid, and that lowers the pH a little bit. So what you'll actually be doing is comparing the pHs of these solutions to water at pH 5. If you've got a neutral solution, well, it's going to stay around pH of 5. If you've got a basic solution, it's going to be higher than that, maybe up in the 7 or greater range. And an acidic would be pH 5 or below. Part D now deals with color tests of proteins and amino acids. Biuret is a general test for proteins, and it gives a pink-purple color, we said. The Millen test, a dark red solution, or a dark red precipitate. Those are the things that you'll look for in those photos. And then here's the workup to that last table, gelatin and casein. And you'll put yes or no on these blanks, depending upon whether or not you've got a positive test for tyrosine. Part E deals with protein denaturation. When proteins are denatured, they lose their three-dimensional structure and often precipitate. You see that, for example, when you cook an egg on a skillet. The protein solution precipitates and you get the white gelatinous mass. So here you'll look for protein precipitation, or a solid, in other words. If there's a heavy solid, plus plus, slight solid, a plus, and if there's no solid or very, very little, put a minus. And that completes the experiment part of the lab. Then the questions at the end. Number one, why does ninhydrin stain the skin blue? And we see that in the laboratory quite often, that when students finish this experiment, they've got blue fingertips, and the answer is not because ninhydrin is blue colored, nor does ninhydrin turn blue when it's warmed. Ninhydrin is colorless, so it isn't responses B or C. That's a big clue for you. And let's see, number one, two, three, four, maybe a couple more tips. Your choices here are biuret and the Millen test. One of those is a general test for proteins, and that would be the best response. And finally, number six, again, a big tip. The correct answer is D. More than one answer is correct. And that means A, B, and C are either all correct or two of those are correct. And I'd like you to identify which two of those are also correct. Hey, I hope you have fun with the experiment. Remember to email me or give me a call if I can help.